August 15th is my own birthday, and it is naturally gratifying to me that it should assume its vast significance. Indeed, on this day, I can watch almost all the world movements which I hope to see fulfilled in my lifetime. From a very young age, I had a feeling of great upheaval which was coming to the world. And that I was destined to play a part in it.
Young Aurobindo grew up in England. His father wanted him to imbibe European culture. He immersed himself in European literature and history at St. Paul's and Cambridge. He also mastered diverse European languages. Inspired by the French Revolution and Irish freedom movement, a strong desire to reform human society was brewing in him. Also, he began receiving letters with painful accounts of British aggression over Indians from his father, a man who once admired everything English. He could no longer be a mute spectator while his motherland was suffering. When it was time for him to return to India, Sri Aurobindo had already made a firm resolve to liberate his country.
What we see is a giant Shakti who, awakening into a new world, a new and alien environment, finds herself shackled in all her limbs by a multitude of gross or minute bonds. Bonds self-woven by her past. Bonds recently imposed from outside and is struggling to be free from them, to arise and proclaim herself. We hear on every side a sound of that slow fraying of bonds, here and there, a sharp tearing and snapping. But freedom of movement has not yet been attained. The eyes are not yet clear. The bud of the soul has only partly opened. The titanness has not yet arisen.
When Sri Aurobindo set foot on his motherland, after a gap of 14 years, a vast calm descended upon him. It was a profound spiritual experience which stayed with him for long months afterwards.
O Mother, I bow to thee.
Something within him began to bloom, but he had to reacquaint himself with his country first. He taught himself Sanskrit and other Indian languages, dived deep into the scriptures, translated great epics and legends. He assimilated the essence of India. He began practice of yoga to acquire its power to liberate his country. While in Baroda, he worked closely with like-minded leaders. He also secretly organized revolutionary movements in Bengal and other provinces by inspiring the youth to fight for freedom. The partition of Bengal was a pivotal point in Sri Aurobindo's life. He took a public stance against the British and joined the revolt. His fiery articles for the English weekly Bande Mataram ignited a spark within the youth, and the cry for India's freedom grew louder all over the country.
My first dream was a revolutionary movement which would create a free and united India. We of the new school would not pitch our ideal one inch lower than absolute Swaraj. To strive for anything less than Swaraj would be to insult the greatness of our past and magnificent possibilities of our future. Swadeshi is the method, the way, the road by which the nation advances. Boycott is only the other side of Swadeshi. National education is the training of the mind and heart of the younger generation. There are times in a nation's history when Providence places before it one work, one aim to which everything else, however high and noble in itself, has to be sacrificed. Such a time has now arrived for our motherland, when nothing is dearer than her service, when everything else is to be directed to that end. If you will study, study for her sake. Train yourselves body and mind and soul for her service.
Sri Aurobindo thus laid the foundation for India's complete freedom, Purna Swaraj. In the midst of growing political unrest, he felt the need for spiritual inspiration. So he made his way to a yogi, Vishnu Bhaskar Lele.
It was my great debt to Lele that he showed me this. Sit in meditation, he said, but do not think. Look only at your mind. You will see thoughts coming into it. Before they can enter, throw them away from you till your mind is capable of entire silence. I had never heard before of thoughts coming visibly into the mind from outside. I simply sat down and did it. In a moment, my mind became silent, as a windless air on a high mountain summit. And then I saw a thought. And then another thought coming in a concrete way from outside. I flung them away before they could enter and take hold of my brain. And in 3 days, I was free. The mental being in me became a free intelligence, a universal mind, a receiver of knowledge from all the 100 realms of being, and free too to choose what it willed in this vast sight empire and thought empire.
In a very short time, Sri Aurobindo arrived at the experience of Nirvana. In that state, he resumed writing inspiring articles and giving fiery speeches. He was at the epicenter of the new wave of the freedom movement, which was sweeping throughout India. The fight for freedom grew more intense and radical. The unrest brought chaos. Chaos gave way to violence, and the violence came with consequences. Sri Aurobindo was eventually arrested.
When I was arrested and hurried to Alipur jail, I was shaken in faith for a while. For I could not look into the heart of God's intention. Therefore I faltered for a moment and cried out in my heart to Him, "What is this that has happened to me?" I believed that I had a mission to work for the people of my country. And until then, I should have thy protection. Why then am I here and on such a charge? A day passed, and a second day, and a third. And then a voice came to me from within. Wait and see. The voice of God within me spoke again. The bonds you had not strength to break, I have broken for you. I have another thing for you to do, and it is for that I've brought you here, to train you for my work. Then he placed the Gita in my hands. His strength entered into me, and I was able to do the sadhana of the Gita. I have seen the beauty of immortal eyes and heard the passion of the lover's flute and known a deathless ecstasy's surprise. And sorrow in my heart is forever mute.
Sri Aurobindo experienced divinity in all things. With it, a whole new range of spiritual experiences began to unfold. Later, he heard a guiding voice. It was of Swami Vivekananda.
He didn't say supermind. Supermind is my own word. He just said to me, this is this, this is that, and so on. That was how he proceeded, by pointing and indicating. He visited me for 15 days in Alipur jail. And until I could grasp the whole thing, he went on teaching me and impressed upon my mind the working of the higher consciousness, which leads towards the supermind.
The emergence of this new consciousness was the beginning of transformation within Sri Aurobindo. He became profoundly free even before he was acquitted from the jail. From this point, he embraced a novel way of action in the world.
When I came out of jail, I listened for that cry of Bande Mataram. But there was instead a silence. A hush had fallen over the country, and men seemed bewildered. No man seemed to know which way to move. And from all sides came the question, what shall we do next? What is there that we can do? But I have not been disheartened by that silence, because I have been made familiar with it in my prison.
Sri Aurobindo was unfazed by the complacency of the people. He knew exactly how to motivate them into action with his words and clarity of thought.
Said thou art weak in thy lands. When the swords flash out in twice 70 million hands, and 70 million voices roar thy dreadful name from shore to shore. With many strengths who art mighty and stored. To thee I call, Mother and Lord, Bande Mataram. Bande Mataram.
For him, the freedom of India was already a certainty. His focus was shifting towards India's role in the spiritual transformation of the world.
The time has come when India can no longer keep her light to herself, but must pour it out upon the world. Yoga must be revealed to mankind, because without it, mankind cannot take the next step in human evolution.
So, he withdrew from active politics. He could foresee mankind heading towards an evolutionary crisis, and India had the key to to the spiritual evolution of mankind.
With wind and the weather beating around me, up to the hill and the moorland I go. Who will come with me? Who will climb with me, wade through the brook, and tramp through the snow?
He worked towards bringing the light of the supermind to erase the darkest forces lurking within the human race. A work that he did in solitude. He was discovering a new path, synthesizing all the yogic traditions of India and going beyond. He called it the integral yoga, a yoga of evolutionary transformation of human nature. Only a few understood and followed his path. But soon he found his equal and spiritual collaborator in his work, Mira Alfasa, whom he later called Mother. With her arrival, his ashram took birth in Pondicherry and grew into a pioneering laboratory for the evolution of consciousness.
He who I am was with me still. All veils are breaking now. I have heard his voice and borne his will on my vast, untroubled brow. But I dare not rest till my task is done and wrought the eternal will. A little more and the new life's doors shall be carved in silver light with its aureate roof and mosaic floors in a great world bare and bright. I shall leave my dreams in their orgeant air. For in a raiment of gold and blue, they shall move on the earth, embodied and fair, the living truth of you. I saw them cross the twilight of an age. The sun-eyed children of a marvelous dawn. The great creators with wide brows of calm. The massive barrier breakers of the world. And wrestlers with destiny in her lists of will. The laborers in the quarries of the gods. And the messengers of the incommunicable. The architects of immortality.
Call is to young India. It is the young who must be the builders of the new world. They must focus on that vision for the future, dedicate themselves in the present, referring to the learnings from the past.
We do not belong to the past dawns. But to the noons of the future.